Hi guys, good morning. So today we are going to discuss our next topic, that is the fixed orthodontic appliances. So the fixed orthodontic appliances are the appliances which are fixed or fitted onto the teeth by the operator, and these cannot be removed by the patient. At a will, these are called as fixed appliances. Fine. So when we are placing the bracket, these are the fixed orthodontic treatment. So when we are placing the bracket, the possible tooth movement using the fixed orthodontic appliances or using the brackets, it causes tipping, it causes the bodily movement, intrusion, extrusion, torquing, uprighting and rotation of the teeth. These all are the possible movement. So next are the stages and the steps of the orthodontic treatment, in which first is the leveling and aligning. So if a patient comes to you with a chief complaint of proclination and the crowding, so first you need to level and align the teeth. Second is the space closure. If you extract first premolar, now after the leveling and aligning, you have level and align all the teeth, that is from canine to canine. Now you want to retract the teeth canine to canine into the extraction space. So that is what space closure is. Next is the finishing. When the space get closed, when the extracted premolar space get closed, then you proceed with the finishing. And at last, when you remove the braces, when you remove the brackets from the tooth, then you give the retainer. This is what the retention is. Right? So there are three types of appliances: the edgewise appliance, the Beggs appliance, and the straight wire appliance. Now we are using the straight wire appliances. Right? So the edgewise appliances. So in this, the angle, it was the last contribution to the orthodontics of angle. Right? So he introduced this edgewise technique in year 1928. Right? He used the horizontal bracket. So what he did was, he used all the brackets of same size. Right? Then if you want to derotate any tooth, if you want to decrowd any tooth, if you want to intrude or extrude any tooth, you have to do the wire bending. You have to place the bends into the wire. So basically, he introduced three bends: the first order bend, the second order bend, and the third order bend. The first order bend is the in and out or up or down bend. He was introduced three bends. First order bend was in and out, important for your MCQ, in and out and up and down. So the first order bend was, for example, this is your arch. This tooth is slightly palatally placed. Now you have to take this tooth out. So for that you have to place out bend. Right. Similarly, if your tooth is out of the arch or buckly place, you have to take this tooth into an arch. So that point of time you can give the in bend. Right. So first order bend are in and out bend. Second order bend are, these are the tip bends or the artistic bend, commonly asked MCQ. With this image based, in this, for example, this is your tooth and this is its long axis. So this is tip. Right? So second order bend is your tip, that is also called as artistic bend. Third order bend is your torque is something like your buckle. For example, this, your long axis and your, this is the torque. This is the buccolingual movement. Right? This is what the torque is. So first order bend is your in out bend, second order bend is your tip bend. This was there in your 2016 exam. And this is the image. And the third order bend is your torquing or the torque bend. Fine. Second is your Beck's appliance. Beck's appliance, it was given by Raymond Beck. Raymond Beck, he used the high strength SS wire, stainless steel wire, with the number of auxiliaries and the spring. He used the auxiliary and the spring to achieve the desired tooth movement. Therefore, he used the vertical slot. This is the vertical slot. In this, it's the slot, it faces gingivally. Right? So you have to place the wire vertically. Like this is your slot. Now you have to place the wire vertically. And this is up facing gingivally. So the Raymond Beck, he used the vertical slots. He used the vertical slot with facing the gingivally. And to secure the wire into the slots, he used the lock pins. He used the lock pins to secure the wire in the slot. Right? Third, we are using nowadays the straight SWA, that is the straight wire appliance. It was given by Lawrence F. Andrews in year 1970. He customized the bracket. He put the tip and torque into the bracket. So in the straight wire appliance, there will be no wire bending. But in the edgewise angle, introduced the wire bending technique. And in this, because all the brackets, these are of same size. But in the straight wire appliance, there will be no wire bending. The tip and torque, these are already placed in the bracket. So these are, we are using a customized bracket. So these are on the basis of the Andrews 6 keys to normal occlusion, as we have already discussed this. So what Andrews did was, he used the, or he angulated the slot. Instead of using this slot, he just angulated the slot. He just angulated the slot to achieve the tooth movement, to achieve any kind of tooth movement. Fine, so this is the basic difference, and he also uses the horizontal slot. Fine. So after this, yes, there are in the Beck's appliance, there are three stages, which are commonly asked question. Three stages. The first stage, it is concerned with the alignment. It is concerned with the alignment. It is concerned with the correction of crowding. Correction of crowding. It is concerned with the rotation correction. It is concerned with the closure of anterior spaces, and therefore achieving edge to edge relationship. Fine, so stage 1, it is called as an alignment stage. So it is concerned with the alignment. It is concerned with the correction of crowding, in the rotation correction, in the closure of the anterior space and edge-to-edge relationship. While the second stage of the Beck, in stage 2, the remaining extraction space are closed while maintaining all these previously stage 1 corrections. Fine. And in stage 3, the final stage, it is consist of uprighting and torquing. Fine. This is commonly asked MCQ. In stage 1, there will be aligning, or the there will be an alignment, correction of the crowding, your rotation correction, your closure of the anterior space and edge to edge. In second stage, extra closure of the remaining extraction spaces, and third stage consists of uprighting and torquing. So this is about the edgewise appliance, the Beck's appliance, and the straight wire appliance. So the edgewise and the straight wire appliance, they use the horizontal slot, while the Beck's appliance, he use the vertical slot. Next technique is the lingual technique. So lingual technique, it was given by Craven Kurz in year 1976. So the wires you are commonly used in the straight wire appliance, these are your tapered wire, your ovoid wire, and your square wire. These three types of arch form, or these three types of wires or arch form, we are commonly used in straight wire appliance. But in the lingual technique, what is the lingual technique? In this, the brackets, these are placed on the palatal and on the lingual surfaces of the anterior and the posterior teeth. Right? So the lingual technique, it is highly aesthetic, but there is a disadvantages of the lingual technique or the lingual braces. It leads to poor access and it leads to the difficulty in speech, and therefore difficulty in maintaining the oral hygiene. Right? So in the lingual technique, we use the mushroom shape arch wire. The mushroom like. Fine. So next step are your basic step are your banding, your bonding, arch wire placement and ligation. These are your complete steps of placing a bracket. So starting with the first, that is the separator placement. So for the banding, you need to create a space, proper space for the banding. For that, you need to place the separator to create the space. Therefore, you can use the ring separator. So the ring separators are, these are the ring separators. These are usually placed in between the interproximal area to create the space for banding. And these are placed with the help of separator placing plier. Right? These are the ring separators. These are the small elastic rings. These are the small elastic rings that are passed through the contact by using the separator placing plier. Second are the dumbbell separators. These are in the shape of the dumbbell. Right? So it is a piece of an elastic that is first stretched and then passed through the interdental contact. When these two separators, these are failed to create the space, or these are failed to get into this interproximal area, in that case we will use the Kessling separator. It is made up of an Australian wire or the AJ Wilcock wire. Fine. So this is a spring separator. Fine. So the spring separator, it consists of a coil and a two arms. This is a coil and these are the two arms. So the shorter arm, it of the spring, it is passed like this below the contact, right? And the longer arm, it will place above the contact area, and the two arms, they are tried to come back to the position and they will break the contact. So you are using three kinds of separator: ring, dumbbell and Kessling separator. So after this, when you create the space, when the space is created with the help of the so after placement of separator, it usually take 1 week and it will create a gap in the interproximal area. Now it's a time to place a band. So this is the first step of a fixed orthodontic treatment, placing a band. So the band, it is made up of stainless steel. These are the band which are made up of the stainless steel, right? So the attachments are already present. In the buccal side, there will be buccal tubes, right? For the passage of the wire, there is a hook. The hook, it should face DG. It means the hook, it should place distally and The band should be placed gingivally. It means the hook, it should be placed distally and gingivally. Fine. So the indication of using the banding are better capability of resisting the occlusal forces, better likely to resist the heavy forces in case of headgear. Banding is preferred on the teeth having the crowns, and just you have to lute the band onto the tooth with the help of GIC. So after the banding, now second step is the bonding. Bonding is the main step. It is the method of fixing the attachment like a bracket directly onto the tooth over the enamel using the adhesive resin. This is called as bonding. Fine. So bonding, it is of two types, the direct bonding and the indirect bonding. So the direct bonding means this is a crown of a tooth, this is an enamel, just directly place the bracket onto the tooth by etching and cleaning and etching and sealing. And indirect bonding means first you need to place the brackets onto the plaster model. Fine. So starting with the first, that is the direct bonding. First, it is directly bond, or it is directly bond the bracket onto the tooth. So there are various steps. Step number one is the cleaning. So first step is the cleaning of the tooth. The crowns of the tooth has to be cleaned, that are to be bonded. These are first to be cleaned by using a pumice. Why? To remove the plaque or any organic debris which are present onto the crown or the enamel of the tooth. So after the cleaning, next is the moisture control. So in this, the teeth is washed and the teeth are dried. Fine. So teeth are washed and teeth are dry, and the moisture control, it should be maintained by using the saliva ejectors and by using the cotton rolls. So if a patient having an excessive salivation, in that case you can give the tablet of methentheline, that is 50 mg per 45 kg of body, taken 15 minutes before the start of the treatment. Apart from methentheline, you can also give probenthine and atropine sulfate. Fine. So third step is the enamel conditioning. So in this, now after the moisture control, next is the enamel conditioning. So in this, you can do the acid etching technique, or you can etch the tooth. So very important, commonly asked MCQ, acid etching technique was given by Bunokor in year 1955. So in this, the tooth after the moisture control, it should be acid etched with the help of 37% of phosphoric acid for 15 to 30 seconds. So after 15 to 30 seconds, now you washed off the tooth with the water and dried with the air spray. And when you dried the tooth with the air spray, there will be a frosty white appearance. Important MCQ. Fine. So after the frosty white appearance, now you can apply the a single coat of sealant. Fine. And then gently air steam for 1 to 2 seconds. Fine. So last step is a bonding. Now after the air dry, now you hold the bracket with the help of the tweezers, and at the back of the bracket there will be a meshwork. This is the back of the bracket, this is the meshwork. So in the back, on the back of the bracket, you have to place the adhesive, and then now you directly place the bracket onto the etched surface of the tooth, and then you just and adjust the angulation and long axis of the tooth, and then just press the bracket and there will be a flash. Then you have to remove the excess flash, and then from the Boone's gauge or with the MBT gauge, you just need to angulate it mesiodistally and incisogingivally with the help of the Boone's gauge and MBT gauge. This is a commonly asked image based question. These two are image-based questions. This is the Boone's gauge, this is the MBT gauge. So with the help of these gauge, either of the two, you can angulate them, you can angulate the bracket either mesiodistally or incisogingivally, and then you need to light cure the bracket. This is what a direct bonding is. Now after this, coming on to the indirect bonding. So it was given by Silverman and Cohen. So in this, when patient comes to you, you just need to take the impression, then pour the cast in the impression plaster. Right? So the indirect bonding, it involves the temporary attachment of the brackets onto the plaster model using the temporary glues or the composite resin. Fine. Now you have to transfer the tray, which is made up of either silicone putty or the thermoplastic material tray. It is adapted over the model. Fine. So as to incorporate the bracket onto the thermoplastic sheet. Now after this, the bonding resin, it is applied over the base of the bracket. Base of the bracket, you have to apply the resin. And now this is the tray. This is the thermoplastic tray having the brackets in it. Now you have to control the moisture in the oral cavity and etch each of the tooth with the help of 37% of phosphoric acid, and then they air dried it. There will be four frosty white appearance. Then direct place this thermoplastic plate onto the tooth and then light cure it. When you remove the tray, the bracket will be automatically bonded onto the tooth or onto the teeth. Fine. So what are the advantages of the indirect bonding? Important. The advantages are, number one is they permit the more accurate placement of the bracket. Second is reduce the clinical chair side time. Third is fewer appointments for the placement of the appliance. These are the three very important advantages of the indirect bonding. So after this, first is your separator placement. Then when the gap is created, secondly you have to place the band. Third is you have to place a bracket. So after placing the bracket, as I've already told you, there are two types of brackets, the edgewise and ribbon arch. The edgewise bracket, these are facing horizontally, and the ribbon arch, these are facing vertically. Fine. These are called as these are used in the Beck's appliance, and the edgewise bracket, these are used in the edgewise and straight wire appliance. So after this, coming on to the types of the bracket, first are the metal brackets. So these are the metal brackets. So it is most commonly used in the orthodontic treatment. It can be easily recycled. It can be easily sterilized. It resists fracture. It has a least friction and it is not very expensive. These are the advantages. Now coming on to the disadvantages, obviously it is not aesthetically pleasing because of its metallic structure. Therefore it is called as a metallic smile. It can corrode and also it can cause staining of the teeth. These are the disadvantages. Second are the ceramic bracket that are of tooth color. It is made up of the aluminium oxide and the zirconium oxide, commonly asked MCQ, and these are aesthetically pleasing. Why? Because the color is same as that of the tooth, dimensionally stable, and they resist the staining. Disadvantages are, they are very brittle, that tends to fracture. These are bulky than that of the metallic braces or the metallic brackets. They exhibit the greater friction. So in this, they have a greater friction than that of the metal brackets. Third are the plastic brackets. So these are the plastic brackets. These are made up of polycarbonate or any modified form of polycarbonate. These are available in a tooth color or a transparent form. Disadvantages are, they tend to discolor. For example, the coffee stain or the smoke stain. they have a poor dimension stability, important. The slots, they tend to distort, important. The friction between the plastic brackets and the metal arch wire is very high, MCQ. Fourth one are the SLV, that is the your self-ligating brackets. So these are the brackets, these are their slots. You just need to open the slot, place the bracket and close the slot. In these, there is no need of ligation, like in the metal bracket, like in the ceramic bracket, you have to place the modules or you have to place the ligature wire. So in this self-ligating bracket, you don't need to put any kind of modules or ligature wire. You just need to open the slot, place the arch wire and close the slot like this. It is very helpful in maintaining the oral hygiene, and in this the clinician chair time is also reduced. So these are also called as the ligatureless brackets. They exhibit very low friction. It reduces the clinical chair side time, important points. So next are the arch wire. You have placed the bracket, now you have to pass the arch wire for the proper to achieve a proper or desired tooth movement. So in this, various types of arch wires are used. First are the stainless steel arch wire. In this, the austenite stainless steel, it is called as 18x8 stainless steel, MCQ. The stainless steel wire, they exhibit the adequate strength, resilience, formability, adequate spring back. The stainless steel wire, these are biocompatible and these are economical. The properties of each and every wire are very, very important for your MCQ. Commonly asked MCQ from your properties of the arch wire. So you have to note it down. So after the stainless steel wire, next is the niti wire, that is the nickel titanium alloy. So the nickel titanium alloy, it is called as nitinol. It was first invented by the William R. Buechler. So the nitinol is the nickel titanium naval ordnance laboratory. It was invented by the William R. Buechler and introduced into the orthodontic by the Andreessen year 1971. It was niti, it was invented by the Buechler, but it was introduced in the orthodontic by Andreessen. Right? So the nitinol arch wire, they exhibit the property of, they have a high spring back, high working range and low stiffness. The disadvantage of nitinol are, in this the bends, helicals, loops, these cannot be made, and these wire, the niti wires, these cannot be welded or soldered. Important. So these wires cannot be welded or soldered. Next are the beta titanium wires. So beta titanium wires, these are also called as TMA wires, introduced by the Goldberg and Burstyn. They exhibit the properties like the high range of action and spring back property. In this, the loops and the helix, these are formed. And the beta titanium, it can also be welded. Important. Next are the cobalt, chromium and nickel alloys. So these are available as an algalloy, exhibit the adequate spring back property and also exhibit the formability and the biocompatibility. So after this, next are the Optiflex wires. These are developed by MF Telas in 1992, made up of clear optic fibers, and these are highly aesthetic. Why? Because of the tooth color. Exhibit the high resilience, cannot accept the sharp bends. Important. Next are the multi-stranded arch wires. These are made up of number of thinner wires. The wires, these can be twisted or coaxial. Therefore, they exhibit the increased flexibility. Important. So after this, this table is very important for your MCQ. So these are the wire composition. The stainless steel wire having a high stiffness, low spring back property, low deflection rate, good biocompatibility, low resilience and good but weldable joint, but needs to be soldered. Very low friction, formability is good and has a low cost. Algalloy, that is the Rocky Mountain, also called as a Rocky Mountain orthodontics. These are having a high stiffness, low spring back property and the low deflection rate is comparable to the stainless steel. Good biocompatibility, low resiliency, good but welded joint needed to be soldered. low to moderate friction, very good formability, and cost is low. The M nitile, the stiffness is low, high spring back property, 1/4 of the SS load deflection rate, and it leads to some corrosion. It has a high resiliency, not solderable or weldable, higher than that of the SS. It has a poor formability and it is moderately, or the cost is moderate. Beta titanium, these are have an average stiffness, average spring back property, half than that of the SS load deflection rate, very good biocompatibility, the resilience is good but lower than that of the nitile. Jointability is truly weldable and solderable. Important friction is, it has a very high friction, formability is good and has a high cost. A nitile, that is the Chinese and the Japanese nitile, they have a low stiffness, the spring back property is 4 times than that of the stainless steel and higher than that of the nitile. Lower than that of the nitile, the load deflection rate. Biocompatibility is better than that of the M nitile, and the resiliency is better than that of the M nitile. Not solderable or weldable, higher than that of the SS, the friction is poor, formability, cost is very high. Copper nitile, very important archwire, commonly asked MCQ. Lowest stiffness, higher spring back property than all of the other wires. Lowest load deflection. Biocompatibility better than that of the nitile. Resiliency better than that of the nitile. Jointability not solderable or weldable. Friction, it has a higher friction, highest friction than that of the stainless steel wire. Poor formability, very high cost. Last are the multi-stranded wires. They have a low stiffness, high spring back property, and the load deflection rate is comparable to the A nitile, and the biocompatibility is good, high resilience, jointability is good but welded joint needs to be soldered. Friction is very low, formability is poor, and cost is low. Fine. So after this, next are the ligation. Now this is the tooth. Now you have placed the bracket, now you have passed the arch wire, now you have to ligate the arch wire with the bracket. So the ligation, it is, we usually use two types of ligation, the elastic modules and the ligature wire. First is the elastic module. These are made up of two elastic ring that are separated by a variable distance, and it is used to secure the arch wire on into the bracket. Next are the ligature wire. These are the ligature wire, and these are made up of soft stainless steel wire with 0.0092 0.011 inch diameter, and these are used to secure the arch wire to the brackets. You just need to twist it. Fine. So these are the two types of ligation, the elastic module and the ligature wire. Next are the elastic chains. So this is the elastic chain. Fine. These are available as a long chain, and these having a interconnected rings. These are made up of polyurethane material. So the e-chain, it is basically used to close the space between the teeth by stretching the elastic chain. By stretching this chain, these are continuous and these are used to close the space between the teeth. Okay. So next are the elastics. Elastic, these are of different color. These are like rubber bands. Right. And these are made up of latex. Class 1 elastic, from these are known as the intra arch elastic, and these are stretched from the first molar to the canine. This is class 1. Class 2 elastics are, these are class 2. Class 3, these are inter maxillary elastics. And class 1 is intra, class 2 and 3 are intermaxillary elastics. So class 2 is the intermaxillary elastics. These are stretched between the lower molars and the upper canine. This is class 2. Class 3 is opposite of class 2, from the lower canine to the upper first molar. This is class 3 elastic. Next are the box elastics. So box elastic, these are used in case of open bite. For example, this is your canine. So one elastic, it is to be engaged like a box pattern. These are the box elastic. Next are the cross bite elastic, to correct the cross bite, posterior cross bite. Fine. So after this, after leveling and aligning, this is all about the leveling and aligning. Now next is the method to close the space. So the method to close the space, there are two methods, the friction method and the frictionless method. So first is the friction method. So in this is your arch wire. The arch wire is usually 1925 SS wire. So in between the lateral incisor and canine, in the mid of the lateral incisor and canine, you placed a hook. A hook is placed. Fine. Like I'm showing you on this. See, first I am talking about the friction mechanics. So in this, for example, this wire is your rectangular wire, that is 1925 SS wire. So in this, the hooks are soldered in between the hair. The hooks are soldered in between the canine and the lateral incisor onto the arch wire, mesially or distally. And from this, the elastic or the nitric coils, these are attached from the molar till this hook. It is usually retract the canine to canine. Right? So this is the friction mechanics or the sliding mechanics. Second is the frictionless mechanics. So in the frictionless mechanics, we design the loops or the spring. For example, we design the T loop to close the space. For example, we design the omega loop. Right? So these are various types of loops which are used to. These are like we have. This is extracted. Now we have to close the space. So we adjust the T loop like this. Right? And when it get closed, it will bring the canine, the complete arch, in onto the distal direction. So therefore there will be a closure of the space or the space closure. So this is what the frictionless or the loop mechanic is. Right? So after the closure of the space, next is the finishing. So in this, the small diameter arch wires like the 016 SS stainless steel wire or the rectangular beta titanium wires are used. So in this, the vertical settling elastics are also used. In this, you can check for the occlusion, you can check for the angulation and inclination of all the teeth. Fine. So after this, next step is the debonding, that is the removal of the bracket. So you debond the bracket with the help of the debonding plier. So once the bracket, these are removed, the residual or the residual adhesive, these are present onto the teeth, and the residual adhesive, it should be removed with the help of the contra angle handpiece with the help of a dome shaped tungsten carbide burr. With a speed of 30,000 revolution per minute, right, without damaging the enamel. And also you can use the ultra fine diamond burr, but keep this in mind that you do not harm the enamel. And again, you need to polish the, at the end you need to polish the teeth with a profile axis paste. And lastly, you need to put the retainer, either canine to canine or for second premolar to second premolar in case of extraction of first premolar. Right? So this is all about the fixed orthodontic appliances. Please go through it once and try to make the notes. Thank you.